Hello everyone, welcome to Lukman IAS. Today we are going to have the Hindu analysis of 25th November 2020. So let us see which are the important articles in today's the Hindu newspaper. Yes, these are the articles. Let us try to take input from these articles one by one. First article on page number 6. Yes, the context of the article: recently the internal working group of Reserve Bank of India has decided, or let's say given the idea of corporate sector, or let's say corporates entering into the banking sector, they should be given the banking licenses. So this idea has been now severely criticized. This article, along with one of the editorial, also discusses the same issue. That's why we have clubbed that into one article only. So we will discuss this article, how this idea is not good. This is how the article is criticizing. It is giving the background of the idea. So we can understand that the earlier also the RBI has mooted that idea and provided the opportunity for corporates to enter into banking sector. However, all these corporates did not meet the criteria set by RBI to enter into banking sector, and therefore the licenses were not provided. Now again the RBI has come up with the idea of providing such banking licenses to corporates. So the article is discussing the challenges before the RBI, or we can say regulator, when the corporates enter into banking sector. So this is how we will discuss this article. Yes, context here: entry of corporates into banking sector. Okay, an internal working group of RBI has recommended that corporate houses be given bank licenses. Okay, so background of the idea of allowing corporate houses into banking by no means novel. In February 2013, the RBI had issued guidelines that permitted corporates and industrial houses to apply for banking license. Some houses applied, although few withdrew from the application subsequently. No corporate was ultimately given bank license. Only two entities qualified for license, IDFC and Bandhan Financial Services. However, the RBI maintained that it was open to letting it corporates. However, none of the applications had met fit and proper criteria set by RBI. At the same time, in 2014, the RBI restored the long-standing prohibition on entry of corporate houses into banking. This is done through one of the Committee on Financial Sector Reforms 2008, which was chaired by the RBI Governor Raghuram Rajan. The committee had set its face against the entry of corporate houses into banking, and this has been the stance up till now by the RBI, right? So what are the pros of corporate entry into banking, that is advantages? Two important points we can mention here is that it will bring capital into banking and it will bring expertise into banking. So these two arguments put forward for entry of banks, corporates into banking. At the same time, it is argued that many jurisdictions worldwide allow such corporate houses into banking. However, there are some limitations, challenges, like concerns. Main concerns: interconnected lending. The major aspect here is that, or the important concern, that when the corporates are given banking licenses, what will happen is that these banks will lend to its own customers and suppliers, even for the let's say growth of its own entities, or let's say industries. Okay, and this will be the challenge for regulator, that is RBI, to monitor such kind of lending, and therefore this may lead to failure of banks in future. At the same time, concentration of economic power. Yes, already the corporates are having, let's say, concentration of wealth into their hands. Ultimately, such kind of interconnected lending will lead to more concentration of power, or in terms of wealth we can say that. And exposure of safety net provided to banks. So these safety nets that are provided to banks by the government itself, especially the RBI, that whatever the deposits we have as a consumer, or we can say depositors in the banks, those deposits are safe, or we can say insured by the governments, or we can say that regulator. However, this safety nets will be exposed when the corporates are entering into banking sector, right? so to commercial sectors of the economy. So basically these safety nets are provided at present as guarantee to the deposits. These will be exposed to the commercial sectors of the economy. Why? Because those corporates having the own bank, so if the depositor is depositing in those banks, that deposit money, deposited money will be used to lend by those corporates or those banks, we can say that. So this exposes the safety net provided to banks. Along with that, the public sector banks need capital that the government is unable to provide, and such entry of corporates into the banking sector will tend to acquire some stakes of public sector banks, and therefore there will be more and more privatization of banking sector. This is one of the concern. So what is way forward here? There are corporate houses that are already present in the banking related activities in terms of NBFCs. Okay. So there are many private sectors working in non-banking financial companies, and under the present policy, NBFCs with successful track record of 10 years are allowed to convert themselves into banks according to RBI policy. Okay, so this is the good route, we can say that, because within these 10 years the RBI gets opportunity to understand and monitor and regulate activities of these NBFCs or those companies, corporates. And when they are converted into banks, full-fledged banks, so that will be a very good, we can say that, opportunity for regulator to have effective regulation, right? So internal working group believes that NBFCs owned by corporate houses should be eligible for such conversion. This promises to be an easier route for entry of corporate houses into banking. This is what we are saying here. Conclusion, India's banking sector needs reform, but corporate houses owning banks hardly qualifies for one such reform. Okay, so same question statement can be used as a question statement and examine the idea of corporate houses owning the banks in India. So examine means you provide some advantages in terms of pros. You provide some concerns, discuss those concerns here and give way forward. This is how we address the examine command in the question, mains question. Fine. So this is how we need to discuss, try to take input into your notes from this article. Fine. Next article written by Sampath G. So he writes very straightforward, we can say, articles related to social issues, social justice related issues, and exposes the ground reality in such kind of issues in India. So the migrant workers as a ghost among the citizens. So some important inputs, we will talk about the plight of migrant laborers in India. Now we know that after the lockdown imposed in India, which was one of the strict lockdown all over the world. So what happened after that? The migrants were left with only two choices. What are these choices? They were starvation or charity. Okay. And they themselves came up with the third choice over the period of time, to walk back to their villages, their homes, let's say hundreds of kilometers away, risking starvation and deaths. And indeed many died in because of such, let's say, starvation. Nomadic tribes are quintessential migrant community in India. The Indian state governance structure for nomadic tribes is determined by the Habitual Offenders Act 1952, which upholds colonial legacy of treating them either as threat or nuisance while erasing their rights as citizens. So basically, in first part, it gives some, let's say, stories of those migrant laborers, especially tribal people from Rajasthan, and how it has resulted into, we can say that, how the lockdown has impacted them. So ultimately, we can say that the governance structure is very poor when we look at the nomadic tribes, especially or largely these tribes are inherently migrant in India, or migrant community in India. Along with that, we can say the high-handedness provided under the Epidemics Disease Act 1897, section 4 of this provides immunity, protection to the persons acting under act, no suit or other legal proceeding shall lie against any person for anything done or in good faith intended to be done under this act. So it provides immunity to the government officials, and even after more than 120 years later, just now this coronavirus or COVID-19, again this Epidemic Disease Act was invoked, and policemen protected by this legislation would brutally assault desperate migrants for trying to walk home. We have seen the protest during the lockdown time period, how these migrants gathered at railway stations to go back to home, and how the lathi charge was done on those migrant laborers. Right? The challenge is to bridge the social distance between migrant workers and rest of the urban society, including ruling elites. So this is the challenge, we can say, before the society and the government. One of the report observes, a large portion of lowly paid laboring population of our country has historically come from Adivasis, Dalit and socially oppressed caste, as well as religious minorities. Yes, we can understand this is the true fact. In India, largely those coming as a migrant community into the urban areas, they belong to lower caste people or Dalit community, Adivasi, or we can say tribal community, and we can understand that some of them are from religious minorities also. So very good statement in the end, we can say active production of migrant labor, how these migrant labors are produced because of certain economic activities, from worsening terms of trade for agriculture and displacement from land and forest. Yes, we can understand that how tribals are being displaced, their rights are denied over the lands, and their invisible exploitation, how it is being done in low paid wage work in cities and industrialized clusters are two parallel processes that feed into each other. This is the reality, we can understand that. At one place we are producing such migrant community, migrant labor at their source by denying their rights to the lands, by denying the equal terms of for agriculture. How this landless labor, agriculture, farm labor is shifting to urban areas because of such practices, and along with that the tribal people are being displaced. And when they come to the cities, how they are subtly exploited by, let's say, low paid wage work in the cities and industrial clusters. So they are fueling with each other, these processes are fueling each other. So this should be used in society section, even polity section and essay. Very good analysis given in this article. Fine. Yes, Tamil Nadu Puducherry on edge of Nivar closes in. Nivar, the tropical cyclone in Bay of Bengal, is becoming severe cyclic storm, very severe cyclic storm. In the next 18 hours, cross Puducherry and Tamil Nadu coast between Karaikal and Mamallapuram around Puducherry late Wednesday evening. Okay, so wind speed are expected to reach 120-130 km per hour. NDRF ready 22 teams, 12 in Tamil Nadu, 3 in Puducherry, 7 in Andhra Pradesh to handle emergency operations. At the same time, the storm is expected to damage standing crops, trees and thatched rooftops, according to IMD. And advisories have been sent to, let's say, fishermen to avoid going into sea. Right. So, for our understanding, how these cyclones are classified, they are classified on the basis of wind speed by IMD. So you can see here the classification from depression, deep depression, cyclonic storm, severe cyclonic storm, very severe, extremely severe and super cyclonic storm. Right. So this KT is the wind speed in knots. Okay. Or we can understand this 220 km per hour, above that it will be called as super cyclone. So you can see the direction here, the origin Bay of Bengal, and this will have landfall here on the eastern coasts, just down of Puducherry, the Kadalur district in Tamil Nadu, and it will have this much impact, kind of rainfall, severe rainfall which is expected up till Hyderabad. Okay, So yes, this will be we'll have follow up on coming lectures. We'll try to understand how the tropical cyclone is formed. Basic things are given in 11th standard NCERT, the tropical cyclone, how it is formed and all, natural hazards mein diya hua hai. The conditions suitable for formation of tropical cyclone, all these things are given in NCERT. Again, we'll discuss that in coming lectures as a follow up. Name of the cyclone is Niwar. How this naming is done is also we'll discuss that, but today only we'll discuss, we have covered about the classification. In next lecture we'll discuss for that also, yeah, how they are named. Fine. Yes. Yes. PM tells, Prime Minister tells states to prepare for vaccine distribution. Yes. Recently a meeting between Prime Minister and Chief Ministers of states has been conducted, and Prime Minister has told states to prepare for vaccine delivery mechanisms, have such committees in place or monitoring mechanism in place for vaccine delivery. Okay, so kind of infrastructure, the human resource that is needed for vaccine delivery. So all these things should be prepared, as in coming months there will be vaccine available surely, and that is to be delivered at earliest to the priority groups. So that's why the Prime Minister is focusing on that. So for fun purpose, jo aapko bahut sare logon ko pata hoga movie Avengers series, to bahut sare logon ki favorite bhi movie hogi, right? Personally my favorite also. So ek analogy for fun tayar kiya hai, like Avengers assemble endgame mein jaise bolte hain, like our Prime Minister is telling that states assemble to fight the coronavirus here. Right, so similar kind of thing we are going to fight, or we can say vaccine delivery is ultimate fight, we can say that, to tackle the coronavirus. So here Prime Minister is saying that ask the state governments to set up the steering committees and block wise task force to prepare for distribution of COVID-19 vaccine, and when they are available for their disposal. But spent much of his meeting with Chief Minister emphasizing that focus should be still on containing the spread of virus. Right, the government was in touch with real time with vaccine candidate institutions, manufacturers, international organizations, governments coordinating vaccine efforts, and international companies to ensure that information on vaccine availability was up to date. At the same time, while the availability of vaccine was in the hands of scientists, the pricing depended on various factors. As public servants, government should prepare for cold chain spots and availability of staff for dispersal, and also any adverse event regarding side effects of the vaccine. Right. So this is how the Prime Minister has discussed all these concerns related to vaccine delivery and the kind of mechanism that the state should put in place for such vaccine delivery purpose in coming months. Okay. Yes. Poshan Abhiyan needs a boost, study by Niti Aayog. That's why it becomes important. The Poshan Abhiyan, or National Nutrition Mission, a very ambitious project of Government of India to seek or to eliminate the hunger in the country and ensure food security and nutritional security. So that's why it is very important. But before that, the present situation that is reflected through this NFHS 4 National Family and Household Survey 4, that the results were given in 2016. This shows very grim picture of nutritional status of children and pregnant and lactating women in India. Okay, so these facts are important for our essay purpose and GS2 social justice, you can use that. At the same time, this some targets that are given under National Nutrition Mission, it aims to reduce stunting and wasting by 2% a year, total 6% by 2022 among the children, and anemia by 3% a year, total 9% among the children and adolescent girls, pregnant women and lactating mothers. Okay. More than third of the children under 5 faces stunting and wasting, 40% aged, and 40% aged between 1 and 4 are anemic. Over 50% of the pregnant women are found to be anemic, according to this National Family Health Survey. Okay. So we can understand that our goals are very low as compared to, let's say, the targets that are defined, global targets defined by World Health assembly. For example, on stunting, the review says that India's targets are conservative as compared to global targets defined by World Health Assembly, which is prevalence rate of 5% of stunting, as opposed to India's goal of reducing stunting by 13.3% by 2022. So we can understand that the stunting and wasting is very high level in India, and therefore our targets are conservative. We need to achieve those targets to so as to ensure the sustainable development goals of SDG 2. The target of reducing prevalence levels of anemia among the pregnant women from 50.3% in 2016 to 34.4% by 2022, right? So experts also warn that the deepening poverty and hunger may delay achieving the goals defined under nutrition mission. So why this may happen? Because this study does not cover whatever the impact of COVID-19 and lockdown had. Okay, so this was already prepared. This report was already prepared. It is released now by Niti Aayog. So that impact is not yet covered under this survey, and therefore there is possibility that many people have, let's say, drawn into poverty and hunger after that lockdown period or in that lockdown period. Fine. Okay, some important facts you should take input from this article. Sputnik 5 shows interim efficacy of 91%, says RDIF. So this is again one of the good development. Hum bolte hai ki Moderna, Pfizer jo hai, US ki companies hai, those drugs, or we can say those vaccines, will be very costly as compared to that AstraZeneca vaccine. But AstraZeneca vaccine somehow has low efficacy as compared to these two. But Sputnik 5, that is developed by Russia, this is having high efficacy, and hum jo se bolte hai ki Russia hi hamare kaam aane wala hai, all weather friend. So we have collaboration with Sputnik 5 development in India by Dr. Reddy's laboratory, Hyderabad based company. So yes, this will again help, and it will cost around 700 rupees for international markets. So yes, Russian COVID-19 vaccine candidate Sputnik 5 shown an interim efficacy of 91% based on analysis results nearly 1800 volunteers. But none of these volunteers was, let's say, covered from India. Okay, so in India also there are trials of phase 2 and phase 3 going on for this vaccine, and the end results will determine the ultimate efficacy of all these vaccines. We have been following up all these efficacies of all these vaccines. So for Sputnik 5, 91%. Okay. Yes. Jail term fine for unlawful religious convergence in UP. Now on op-ed page, two articles have been written from society perspective, or those who are having sociology optional, unke liye kaafi important hai. Like the kind of, let's say, they are discussing the issue of love jihad, right? So there can be question in society section, but not directly. Indirect question can be there. So we can discuss from that aspect also. Some of the states are, let's say, focusing on bringing law on love jihad, and the UP government has been in, at forefront. This has promulgated ordinance to, let's say, that makes religious conversion a non-blasphemous offense, inviting penalties up to 10 years in prison if found to be affected for marriage or through misrepresentation, force, undue influence, coercion, allurement, or other allegedly fraudulent means. So we can understand that the law will surely test the judicial, in judiciary, be it in High Court or Supreme Court. But yes, these terms are very vague terms, and it can be used, or we can say arbitrarily used, against let's say personal liberty of the person to marry certain person. Along with that, some religious fundamental rights under constitution. In case of conversion done by women for sole purpose of marriage, the marriage would be declared null and void. Now this is, this will be let's say under debate in future. We'll discuss that when the articles will appear. Especially there will be editorial surely on this news. So conversion done by women for the sole purpose of marriage, the marriage would be declared null and void. Now, this is somehow contradictory to our fundamental rights in constitution. Surely, it will be challenged in the judiciary, will have a follow-up on that. Okay. At the same time, some other provisions like ordinance further said that burden to prove that conversion was not done through misrepresentation would be on person converting and those who facilitated it. ठीक है, तो ये स्टेट पे नहीं है बर्डन, रादर इट इज बर्डन ऑन दैट पर्सन. पर्सन सीकिंग टू कन्वर्ट टू अनदर रिलीजन फॉर मैरिज वुड हैव टू बी इन्फॉर्म डिस्ट्रिक्ट मैजिस्ट्रेट 2 months प्रायर टू इट थ्रू ए प्रिस्क्राइब फॉर्म. ओके, सो देर आर सम प्रिस्क्रिप्शन और सम लीगल लेट्स से प्रोविजन अंडर दिस एक्ट सो एज टू हैव अ लॉफुल कन्वर्जन, रिलीजियस कन्वर्जन. सो UP has become, let's say, first state to bring such law on love jihad directly, which is very unrecognized term under law, legally unrecognized term. Okay, that important caption and quotation, very good caption regarding that migrant labor. So, if there is essay or GS2 question, GS1 question on migrant labor. So their situation, a very good statement explaining their plight in urban cities or overall situation in India. Okay, so you can use that in these sections, SA, GS2, GS1 also. Fine. Okay. So these were important articles from today's The Hindu newspaper. For further information on editorial discussion classes or ED classes, wherein in-depth analysis of all mains related articles is done by Ansari sir and team, you can contact Lukman IS. Thank you.